direct from Studio A of the Howell Cheney Technical High School Media Production Shop, it's HCTV News.
Hello, and welcome to a new edition of HCTV News. I'm Morgan Landry.
And I'm Taylor Rinaldi. Coming up in this episode are great stories, including the New York Times contest, of which six students placed at the top. Sophomore Janari Fernandez will be telling us all about the new Beaver logo. And lastly, Matt Motika with his sports update.
First off, the digital media shop students entered a contest sponsored by the New York Times earlier this year, and we did great. The contest required us to define a word from their 1600 word selection from the New York Times Word of the Day blog and compose it in a 15-second video. There were about 900 international entries, and six digital media students placed in the top 44 entries as runner-ups and honorable mentions.
Three sophomores, one junior, and two seniors beat more than 850 entries. The words were autopsy, felon, deflect, hoodwink, random, and toga. Let's check it out.
What's in the bag?
Nothing.
I got a felon.
What's that?
Felon's a noun, and it means someone who's committed a felony. Let's start this autopsy.
Autopsy. Verb. A postmortem examination of a body or organ.
Yoga! Yoga!
Yoga?
Isn't this a yoga party?
No, this is a toga party.
Toga. Noun. A one-piece cloak worn by men in ancient Rome.
Toga! Toga! Toga!
Deflect, verb, change in direction after hitting something.
Hoodwink, to trick or mislead someone.
Random, something lacking in order, plan, or purpose. It happens totally by chance.
By now, we're sure you've heard about Cheney Tech's new Beaver logo.
Sophomore Janari Fernandez has a story behind the change.
Cheney Tech Beaver's logo was recently changed. Students around the school were sent a survey to their CTHSS email that gave students the option to choose from four different logos that they would like to have as the new Cheney Tech logo. Many students and faculty are curious as to why we had to change our Angry Beaver logo.
Mr. Garner, who has been teaching here at Cheney since 1998, gave us some insight as to what he knows about the recent logo change.
It isn't clear as to why we had to change our Beaver logo. All that many of us know about the logo is that it has recently been changed. Mr. Garner remembers the old Beaver logo that used to be painted on the gym wall. Cheney Tech has went through three different logos since 98. Since then, we have always been the Beavers. There are many Beavers logos out there in the country. What do you think about the new Cheney Tech logo? For HCTV News, I'm Janari Fernandez.
Next up, we have a very interesting story about the new bowling club and the history of bowling, which dates back many hundreds of years.
Let's see what Corey Mazzola has to say.
This year, Cheney Tech decided to bring back the bowling club for Club Day. That is a good idea, as bowling is one of the most popular sports in the world. British explorer Sir Flinders Petrie discovered a child's grave in 1930s Egypt that had a collection of objects that appeared to be an old-fashioned game of bowling. If he was right, then bowling started in 3200 BC. The earliest bowling game was a pin game. There were many variations of it. The English, Dutch, and German settlers brought over their own versions of bowling. The first permanent bowling site was lawn pin bowling at a venue located in New York's Battery area. Later in 1941, Connecticut made it illegal to play nine-pin bowling. Nine-pin bowling had become associated with gambling and drinking. Nine-pin bowling was eradicated. Ten-pin bowling was introduced as a way to get around the nine-pin prohibition. Another major change was in 1952, when automated pin spotters became part of the game. It eliminated the need for a pin boy.
Here's how this amazing machine, pioneered and developed by AMF, makes your bowling more fun. After your first ball, deadwood is swept away and the ball is brought back by the modern underlane ball return. With return, underlane brain of the pin spotter works fast, flashes the numbers of pins still standing to AMF's exclusive magic triangle signaling unit. Yes, thanks to the AMF automatic pin spotter, modern bowling's fun for everyone.
Today, bowling continues at Cheney Tech once a month when students go to Vernon Lanes to play. It costs $6. That includes shoes and 1 hour of bowling. Mr. Syke is one of the leaders of the bowling club. He decided to go to Vernon Lanes this year.
We deal with them on project graduation and all. It's a nice lanes. They've done a lot of renovations, but primarily price. I saved a few bucks each time for each student.
The bowling club is really popular, with 21 students enrolled in it. Student bowlers range from beginners to quite experienced.
Bam!
Yes, I have bowled. I bowled in a professional league in my local town for about 5 years, but then quit out and haven't bowled since.
Overall, bowling club is a really fun time for students. They can't wait until the next club day.
Wow, I never knew anything about the history of bowling.
Each year, Cheney students help out with the Rebuilding Together project. This year, it will be on April 29th. Junior Emily Hansen has the overview.
Rebuilding Together is a nationwide program to help people in need, low-income families, improve their property, whether it's painting, carpentry, yard work. Manchester had 800 people today and 82 projects.
Rebuilding Together's main mission is to transform the lives of low-income homeowners by improving the safety and health of their homes and cleaning our communities.
From this experience, I think they have a little more idea what it's all about volunteerism, giving back to the community, and I think they feel pretty satisfied when they're done. They're quite grateful. They're quite grateful. We've had people call up and thank us, and it's good for the school to do this.
For more information, see Mr. Morello. The next rebuilding project is April 29th at 8:30. You get a free t-shirt and a lunch, so help clean up our community.
You've probably received an Amber Alert at some point on your cell phone. Next up, Alana Lise Rivera explains Amber Alerts and how they came out to be.
Let's take a look.
Have you ever received an Amber Alert? Amber Alerts and Silver Alerts are created to help find a missing person. Amber Alert began in 1996 when Dallas-Fort Worth broadcasters teamed up with local police to develop an early warning system to help find abducted children. AMBER stands for America's Missing Broadcast Emergency Response and was created as a legacy to 9-year-old Amber Hagerman, who was kidnapped and later murdered while riding her bike in Arlington, Texas. According to the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, as of February 24, 2017, Amber Alerts have helped rescue and safely return 868 children back to their homes.
Not all missing children are Amber Alerts. There's actual criteria that has to be put into effect in order for an Amber Alert to be broadcasted.
Amber Alerts are broadcast through radio, television, road signs, and cell phones. Besides Amber Alerts, there are also Silver Alerts. Silver Alerts are an alert system for people who are under the age of 18 but do not meet the criteria of Amber Alerts, adults with a mental impairment or medical condition, and any person over the age of 65. The criteria of Amber Alerts are law enforcement confirms an abduction, the child is at risk of serious injury or death, and must be 17 or younger. Amber Alerts can save people's lives. One incident occurred in Bridgeport recently, and involved a parental conflict that resulted in a murder and kidnapping. A six-year-old girl named Aylin Hernandez was kidnapped by her father after he stabbed her mother and her mother's friend, leaving the child's mother dead and her friend in critical condition. An Amber Alert was activated after the child was abducted after the stabbing. A state trooper saw the car they were in and tried to make a traffic stop, but the father refused to pull over. That led to a high-speed chase which ended in the child's father crashing. The child was rescued with minor injuries.
Amber Alerts are very effective in getting the child back into safe hands, if you will. As soon as the Amber Alert is issued, it goes to your text messaging, it goes to breaking news all over the media, it goes to the scrolling marquees over where the lottery headquarters are sold in all the convenience stores, and it's also broadcast over the highway illumination signs. So basically, if there's an abduction anywhere in the United States and an Amber Alert is issued, there's going to be an immediate notification.
If you get an alert and you come across a missing person describing the alert, report it to the police immediately. It can help save someone's life.
Now that you're more aware about Amber Alerts, remember that they should always be taken seriously.
Coming up in April, the PTO is hosting a car show where you can bring your own vehicles here at Cheney Tech's parking lot. Junior Eric Card will clue you in on what it's all about.
This year, Cheney Tech is hosting its first car show on Sunday, April 30th, from 10 to 2 in the school parking lot. The event is sponsored by the PTO. Any type of vehicle is welcome. It could be an antique, a motorcycle, hunk of junk, or even a project car. There is a registration fee for vehicle owners, $10 for students, $20 for non-students. Event chairperson Tanya Beebe says the purpose is to raise awareness that Cheney Tech is a diamond in the rough here in Connecticut. All fees that are raised will go into the PTO General Fund with the possibility of starting a car show account for future events. Registration forms are available in the office or on the Cheney Tech website. The more cars registered, the better. The culinary department is providing refreshments and MDA is creating trophies. Bring your friends, family, and neighbors to enjoy all the different types of cars our community has to offer.
I hope I get to bring my car.
I hope so too. Also, something I love doing is shopping.
Really? I do too. Well, do you like to shop online or in stores?
Actually, I love doing both. Junior Egypt Bell Clayton has a story on online shopping versus bricks and mortar shopping with details on the 2016 holiday shopping season.
In the 2016 holiday shopping season, the U.S. brought in over $91.6 billion in digital sales, which is the highest amount ever made. This is not a surprising fact. 95% of teens say they go online. In 2013, 79% of teen females said that they do like online shopping, and 78% of teen females said that they prefer shopping in stores. 76% of teen males said that they do like online shopping. However, 75% of teen males prefer to shop in stores.
I like buying online. I don't like going and waiting in lines and stuff. I'm very impatient. I don't have a lot of patience. I like ordering stuff. There's more variety of stuff. I think there's more stuff online than there is in store.
I prefer online shopping because online shopping is more cheaper than stores. Actually, gives you good sales.
I like to shop online because online there's a lot of more sales you can allow you to have, and they also have a more wide range of inventory to shop from.
Teens are known to be the ones that go online every day, but adults can also be attached to going online almost constantly as well. A July 2015 survey done by the Pew Research Center, a nonpartisan polling and analysis center, showed a demographic breakdown of how often various age groups go online. Of those that go online almost constantly, young adults lead the way with 36%. Following behind are adults ages 30 to 49 with 28% being heavy users of online. Adults ages 50 to 64 come next with 12%. And finally, only 6% of adults ages 65 and older go online almost constantly. Many teens and adults used online shopping to do their holiday shopping for the 2016 holiday season. But this was a problem for bricks and mortar sales because with more people shopping online, it was harder to attract shoppers to stores. In-store sales have gone up during the recent holiday season, but they were going up slower than online shopping sales and failed overall seasonal growth rates because more people preferred to do online shopping than take a trip to the store. Many teens decide to go to the mall nowadays because they have more free time than other age groups and normally see the mall as a social and cultural place or a way to simply shop or just get out of the house.
I prefer shopping in stores because I get to see what's in stock and I can see what's available in the store instead of having to go online and see what's there or what's not.
I prefer shopping in store because then I can try on the clothes and see if it fits. Because online, you pick things and not everything fits when you get it in the mail.
I prefer in stores because I like walking around and I can actually see what I want to buy and try it on in stores.
Many teens don't go to stores just to shop. They also go to spend time with their friends.
I like going in real life because like, you can see the stuff in your... It's true though, you can see the stuff, you can see how it is, you can try it on. I mean, I like going with my boys, you get to chill, so I like going in real life.
With people starting to do more online shopping, stores are starting to close down, meaning that bricks and mortar sales are being challenged. On December 27, 2016 and January 4, 2017, it was announced that 100 Kmart stores and 42 Sears stores will be closing this spring. 68 Macy's stores have already started to close down, beginning in early 2017.
I prefer both because online it has more options, but in stores you can try stuff on, but there's not as many options.
In case you were wondering, the most popular gifts bought for kids were Hatchimals, Star Wars gear such as the Star Wars Smart R2-D2 app-controlled robot, the SWS-1BL Black Series helmet, and the Star Wars Lego sets. Pokemon video games such as Pokemon Sun and Pokemon Moon. Lego such as the Lego City Volcano Exploration Base and Lego Minecraft for online. And the Little Life Pets Snuggles My Dream Puppy. The most common gifts bought online for teens and adults is Amazon Echo and Echo Dot, Amazon Fire TV Stick with Alexa, Fujifilm Instax Instant Film Camera, and Sony PlayStation 4 Slim. Even though bricks and mortar sales are being challenged and the number of retail stores are going down, they are not going away. Hopefully next holiday season and many more years to come, more people will decide to do both online shopping and shopping in stores.
My most popular gift was the PlayStation 4.
Really? Mine was the Amazon Fire Stick.
Well, recently, freshmen and seniors participated in Take Your Parents to Shop Day. Sophomore Daniel Marks has the details. Check it out.
Bring Your Parents to Shop Day was created when Korea Night got canceled due to a power outage. The Family Engagement Center scheduled this event so parents could meet their kids' trade teacher and get to know their shop. Usually planning a big event like this takes a lot of work.
Well, when you prepare an event of this magnitude, it requires a lot of planning. You have to, first of all, we gave ourselves 1 month of preparation. And we had to send the invitation, reserve the date, make sure everybody in the school was aware of the fact that parents were going to be visiting. We had to make arrangements for the breakfast that we serve. So it really requires a lot of preparation.
Since the Family Engagement Center team had a good turnout, they're planning on doing it again next year. During this event, there were parents who couldn't speak English and needed translation. So we asked Ms. Sanchez what would she do differently since she is bilingual herself.
Sure, I would definitely make sure that there is translation, particularly for those parents that speak Spanish and that do not understand English. So I will make sure that we have documents in Spanish for them and that there is coverage for translation in every trade that they visit.
We hope to see you in April at our next Bring Your Parents to Shop Day.
That looked like a lot of fun. It's a great way to bring seniors and freshmen together.
It really is. Finally, check out the sports update, a 2017 spring outlook and a wrap-up of the fall and winter season by Matt Motika. Let's have a look.
Hello, and welcome to Cheney Tech Sports Update. I'm Matt Motika. This episode features a short wrap-up of the fall and winter seasons and with special attention paid to some of the changes made to this year's spring teams. Starting off, this fall, the Cheney Tech soccer team finished with a record of 5 wins, 9 losses, and 4 draws, securing them a spot in the conference playoffs. Unfortunately, we were eliminated in the first round by the defending champions, Harding High School, 7-2. Football did not qualify for the state tournament, but finished with a winning record of 6-4. The cross-country team had a great season as well, with everyone improving and running their best times at the end of the season. Sophomore Matt Krob was also very successful, making all-conference for his second year in a row. Moving on to the winter teams. The girls basketball team did not make the playoffs and finished with a respectable 8-12 record, led with a lot of offense throughout the season. The boys team underperformed this year, finishing with a 3-17 record. With the winter coming to a close and the warm weather approaching fast, softball and boys track are looking to have good season with a strong core of returning players and runners. The baseball team and its coaches are hoping to have a great season. I recently talked with Braden Barone and Chandler Zanata. We discussed topics ranging from personal and team goals to improvements and the coach turnover. Let's roll the talk. Hello and welcome to this inside scoop of the sports update. I'm here with senior Braden Barone and senior Chandler Zanata. This is going to be an inside look into the baseball team. Now, I'm pretty sure you both are aware that Coach Batch and Coach Barry had left the team due to personal reasons. How do you feel about the two new coaches that have joined? Are you happy that they joined, or are you kind of upset about it?
I'm actually really happy. You know, we had Sylvia our sophomore year. He did a really good job. I feel like he made some really key calls throughout the season. Mr. Arcioli, I also have a very good feeling about him, seeing how he still plays baseball now. You know, I'm sure he knows a whole lot, which will not only improve myself, but I feel like he has a lot to offer to the team.
What about you?
I think Mr. Sylvia is a great coach. He's already got conference championship experience. He was the head coach when me, Braden, and you won the 2015 CSC. So he's definitely got the experience, and he's got a lot to offer us. And Mr. Scioli played under Lego when he was in Babe Ruth, so he knows Lego's mentality. That's yet to be decided. But Mr. Scioli has a lot to offer this team, and I'm very excited to see what he can do.
With the old coaching staff, what was your relationship? Do you think they were as intense, or were they at points? Do you think they could have been better?
To be honest, I Mr. Bash and Mr. Barry, I both respected them both. You know, they were both very picky with people in a good sense. You know, picked out the little things to make you even better. If a player didn't praise, it was more of it. They praised when they needed to, but they also were very correcting to people, which I thought was a big thing at this, especially at this level.
What was your relationship with Coach Batch and Coach Barry?
Coach Batch was an amazing coach here. He's got he's got one win under his belt as a head coach here, so he makes him the winningest head coach in Cheney Tech history. He was a great pitching coach, and now he's at Wyndham Tech, and he's going to do a great job there. Mr. Barry, or Coach Barry, was a great coach, and they both played college baseball, so they had a lot to offer us, and they made us better every day, and they're going to be missed, but I'm ready to see Mr. Scioli and Mr. Sylvia take the wheel and see what they can do.
Now, what is your relationship with Coach Lego, the head coach?
Coach Lego, good relationship. You know, he's been with me since sophomore year, when I first started playing varsity. I feel like his voice is, the way he delivers or carries himself is good. And he definitely knows a lot about the game. He knows how to run a team. So, yeah, I feel good about him.
Well, I know you're in his shop, so you had to spend an extra 2 years with him more than we get. So has that hampered your relationship, or has that made it better?
I definitely think it's made it better. I get to talk to him about strategy during the day as well as out on the field. He's a great coach. I've learned a lot from him. He knows a lot. And what his experience is something to be desired. He's a great coach, and I cannot wait to get the season started.
I know, it's getting close. It's at a point where we're almost getting nervous. You know, everybody's got those first day jitters, just like the pros. pitchers and catchers report. In fun, it's what's the point, right?
Yeah,
exactly.
We're all trying to win games, and we all want to do the best we can. And if that doesn't work out, then it sucks, yeah. But life goes on.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd like to thank you two both for joining me today for this episode and this little discussion with the baseball team. My name is Matt Motika, and I will see you next time. Some awesome points in that discussion. We all hope for one goal, to win the conference championship. With the new captains and new coaches, everyone hopes to grow and improve on all aspects of the game. We will continue to update you as the season goes on. If you like this episode, make sure to like and subscribe for more content. For this update, I'm Matt Motika.
Great sports update. I can't wait for next year's edition.
Me too. Well, that's all for today's episode. Signing off, I'm Taylor Rinaldi.
And I'm Morgan Landry.
See you next time.